idea is to be able to solve systems of linear equations. As you know, a matrix actually represents a system of linear equations. What you have learned in high school might be something like, if you have as many equations as unknowns, you can solve them. But that's not quite true, we will see. Let's take a positive example where you can actually solve them. So two equations and two unknowns. So x plus y equal to 5, x minus y equal to 1. You can just add these two equations. Y and minus y will cancel. We get 2x. 5 plus 1, 6. So that means x is equal to 3. And subtract them. X minus x is 0. Y minus minus y is 2y. And that becomes 5 minus 1, 4. You get y equal to 2. So you can, it looks like you can solve two equations when you have two unknowns. Why is that the case? What do these equations represent? So let's look at that in a coordinate space. One equation, which is a line, x plus y equal to 5. So when x equal to 0, y equal to 5, y equal to 0, x equal to 5, so 2 points, a line. And I have another equation, x minus y equal to 1, so x equal to 0 will mean y equal to minus 1, and so on. So you get another line. They are at an angle with each other, so they intersect at some point, and that point is common between these two lines, so that point satisfies both the equations. So you get the red equation and the blue equation satisfied, and that point is x equal to 3, y equal to 2. So that's a solution. This is actually possible because these equations are what we will call independent and consistent. Now, if you don't have two equations, you have only one equation and two unknowns, too few equations, does it have solutions? Yes, because you can find any value of x and y satisfying this will be a solution. So suppose I choose some value of x, say t, then y equal to 5 minus t, that is a solution because that is on the line. So any value of t in R is good enough, and you have an infinity of such values, so you have an infinity of solutions. Now let's look at another situation where I have two equations and two unknowns. Can you solve these two? And how many solutions will you have? Two equations and two unknowns. It might look as though you have two equations, but if you look at it, the second equation is the first equation times two. Really, you have only one equation. That is when I say that the equations are not independent. So again, choose any value for x equal to t, and any value that will add up to that value of x to give you 5 will be a solution. Now let's look at one more situation, which kind of points to you that it's not always true that if you have as many equations as unknowns, you can always solve. So two equations again, x plus y equal to 5, x plus y equal to 6. There's no pair of x and y that will satisfy both the equations. That's what I mean by inconsistency. They cannot be both true at the same time. So the first equation, x plus y equal to 5, is that line, the red one. The second one is another line. There will never be a point which will belong to both the lines, and you cannot. So what we will say is that the equations are not consistent. They are inconsistent equations resulting in parallel lines. Now they don't really always have to be parallel. There are other ways of being inconsistent. You can have lines that do not meet but that are not parallel in higher dimensions. Now suppose you have too many equations. Let me give you three equations. The first two are the same, but I have one more equation. Now do you have solutions for the three equations here? Is there a point that is common to all three lines? Is there a pair of values x and y which will satisfy all three equations? The third equation is not independent, can be derived from the other two equations. Equation 3 really is equation 1 plus 2 times equation 2, something like a linear combination. So that equation is not independent. I have the first and second equations like that, and I have the third one, the green equation, which happens to go through that particular point, which is common to the red and the blue ones. So there is a solution to all three equations. They're consistent, but they're not independent. The green one is not independent of the other two. Let me give you one more permutation of the situation. I again have three equations. Now the third equation looks similar, but in this case, instead of 7, I have 9, which means it's not really derived from the other two. The left-hand side is derived from the other two, but the right-hand side is not. The third equation is not consistent with the other two. The first red equation, the second blue equation, and the third green equation now doesn't go through the solution here, but it cuts the other two lines in some other points. So I get something like a triangle there. So there's no solution. Inconsistent equations, no single point of intersection. So there's another way of being inconsistent. Although there is no solution, is there a way in which I can kind of say that there is an approximate solution or a point in this space that kind of best satisfies the three equations? or comes closest to satisfying the three equations? Is there such a point? Can you see such a point? Somewhere inside the triangle, maybe something like the centroid of the triangle, you could probably think of that as the approximate solution, the best possible solution. It's not a solution. I think I shouldn't really call it a solution because it is not in any one of the three lines, really. What is the best possible that you can think of? That way of thinking actually leads to the idea of the machine learning technique called linear regression, multiple lines, and you're trying to figure out the best possible solution, although you know that there is no real solution. And linear algebra will give you a very nice way of actually figuring out the best possible solution, naturally and elegantly. I had two equations in the beginning, in the first example. Nice equations, independent and consistent. So I had a solution. The second example, I had only one equation, an infinity of solutions. The system is not constrained enough to give me a single point. The third one looked like I had two equations, but the second one was not independent. Again, infinity of solutions, because it was the same as the second example, really. Then the fourth one, we started running into trouble. Two equations again, but these equations were not consistent with each other, and they actually formed parallel lines in the coordinate space. No intersection, no solution. And then we went on to three equations. In this fifth example, we did have a solution because the third equation happened to be consistent with the rest of the equations, and it's not independent, but that was okay. It was consistent. In fact, with two variables, you cannot have a third equation that is consistent and independent at the same time. The last example was similar to the previous example, but the third equation was not consistent with the rest. Again, inconsistent equations will mean no solutions. What they told you in high school, that if we have as many equations as unknowns, we can always solve them, is not true. The closest we can get to that statement is something like this. If we have as many consistent and independent equations as unknowns, we can uniquely solve them. We can get a unique solution. If not, if you don't have that, we don't really know what's going on. This obviously is not a very satisfactory situation. We want to do better than this. So even for a very simple system of two equations, we had so many permutations. But if you have many more variables and many more equations, it's very difficult to see what's consistent, what's inconsistent. So that's what will happen when you go to Rn. All right, so let's look at how we can summarize what we know so far in R2 and R3 and then going on to Rn. So we worked with two variables. That means we were in R2. We could extrapolate that to R3. Again, we can probably visualize it. Then we will go on to Rn, where n is actually greater than 3. Where we cannot really visualize it, but we will extrapolate our mathematical intuition and insights into that also. That's the game we play in linear algebra. If you have one equation, in R2 what you have is a single line. Any point on the line is a solution to that equation, so infinite number of solutions. If you have one equation in R3, what is it that you have? So I have R3 here, x, y, and z, and I'm going to give you an equation, a simplest one I can think of, which is x equal to 0. That is a linear equation. What's the shape of that in this coordinate space? If it was in R2, you know that it's going to be a line. X equal to 0 is actually the y-axis. Here is the yz plane. Anything over here in this plane is a solution. So if I take a vector 0, and some value for y, and some other value for z, and take this vector, and this always satisfies x equal to 0 because x is really equal to 0. So y and z can be anything. So that means infinity of solutions. Any point on that plane is actually a solution. If you go to a more complicated situation like x plus y plus z equal to 1 or 3 or something like that, it's still a plane but oriented with respect to the axis in some general orientation. So one linear equation in R3 is a plane. Extrapolating, if you have Rn and if you have one equation, then that becomes a hyperplane or a subspace, or n minus one dimensional subspace. So what's going on is this. If you have an equation, it is kind of like taking away one degree of freedom that you have. If you are in R2, the moment I specify an equation, it takes away one degree of freedom. It basically gave you a one-dimensional entity in that space. Similarly, in R3, you take away one degree of freedom, then you get a plane because you have two dimensions left. In Rn, you have n minus one dimensions left, which is like a hyperspace. Now, if you have two independent and consistent equations in R2, I have taken away both the degrees of freedom, then what is left is a zero dimensional entity, which is a point, a unique solution that is common to both the equations. In R3, what's going to happen is that you have one plane by one equation and another plane by another equation. And if the equations are independent and consistent, they are in some random orientation and two planes will intersect in a line. So any point along the line is a solution, so infinity of solutions. In Rn also infinity of solutions, but what's going on there is much harder to visualize. N minus two subspaces intersecting and infinity of solutions again. Now move on to three independent and consistent equations. You cannot have that in R2. You cannot find a third equation that is independent and consistent at the same time because you've run out of dimensions there. There's nothing more you can do. But in R3, if you have one equation, that is one plane, a second equation, another plane cutting the first plane in a line, and third equation at a general angle with respect to these two planes, that will cut the line somewhere, and that point becomes the solution to all three equations. So a point, a single unique solution. In Rn, again, infinity of solutions because you don't have enough constraints. Now, extrapolating again, n independent and consistent equations can never happen in R2 if n is more than 3. It cannot happen in R3 either because n is actually more than 3. You cannot have a fourth consistent and independent equation. In Rn also, what will happen is that you have just enough equation to constrain everything. You will get a single point of intersection if you have n independent consistent equations. So these are all situations where you have solutions. Now, if you have two independent but inconsistent equations, what you saw was that we had parallel lines in R2. In R3, you might get parallel planes, so no solutions. In Rn also, parallel subspaces, so no solutions. Now, three independent but inconsistent equations, then life becomes more complicated. We saw this in our example in R2. We had the red line, the blue line, and the green line forming a triangle. So that is possible, a triangle kind of intersection. Two parallel lines and one line cutting them, so intersection in two points is possible. No intersection at all, three parallel lines, that also is possible. In R3 also, you could have three parallel planes or two planes and then another plane cutting this. Or you have three planes intersecting in three different lines. So they are not parallel to each other, but the intersection looks like three lines and that will make something like a triangular tube. So no common point, so no solutions. But in Rn, it becomes much harder to visualize, but you can say that similar things are going to happen there also. In particular, you can say that there are no solutions. The moment you have inconsistency, you know that you will not have solutions. So same situation, lines that make some of these things, or maybe even more complicated things. Same thing here, planes that are parallel or with complicated shapes. Similar to this, but because you have more planes, you can make more complicated shapes. But no single point of intersection, no solution. In Rn also, same story, but impossible to visualize really. And no solution. So this is my matrix of different situations that can happen. Very complicated. Obviously, we need some way of detecting the different situation. Now, before doing that, let's define what independence is. If an equation cannot be derived from the rest, it's an independent equation. Now, consistency is a much harder concept to pin down. All I can say is that an inconsistent system of equation is the one that has no solutions. But you know what it means, but hard to actually put it down in words. Now, the statement is that the number of independent equations in a consistent system can never be greater than the number of unknowns. You cannot have three consistent and independent equations if you have only two variables. The situation is actually similar to the idea that two linearly independent vectors will span R2. A third vector will necessarily be linearly dependent on these two linearly independent vectors. It's actually the same situation, except that it's a transpose case. We're talking about rows rather than columns. If a system has more independent equations than unknowns, so if you have three equations and two unknowns, the third equation will have to be necessarily inconsistent if it is independent.